Perhaps they'll listen now. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dearest Christ, our King of missionaries, help us to listen to your voice, to hear whatever mission you want to entrust to us. Open our hearts to your mission and teach us how to live our whole lives as a mission like you. Mama Mary, accompany us in this journey and pray for us as we try our best to follow you. You who continues to be faithful to your mission to be our mother and to follow your words when you said, do whatever he tells you. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. Good morning, everyone. My name is Yvonne Romualdez, mother of two and a wife to a most supportive husband who I've been journeying with for 27 years. I first met Verbum Dei in 2011. Father James was celebrating the Velada Mass in Assumption, and I believe there are many Assumption girls here this morning. And I will never forget his sharing about the most important vitamin we need in life, vitamin P. P for prayer. I have been a fan since and tried hard to take this vitamin daily and sometimes more than once a day. When the group was planning this recollection, I was so excited to find out that Ash Wednesday was February 14. I thought, what a perfect way to celebrate Valentine's Day, to have a date with the Lord. Then I got a call if I could give this Lenten talk. And my initial reaction was to give 101 reasons why it was not a good time. But I stopped and prayed. And the words that came to me were, whatever I tell you in the darkness, speak in the light. And whatever I whisper in your ear, announce from the rooftops. God has a sense of humor. This was my view as we were traveling, and we were on the 107th floor of a hotel. And like magic, his words worked, and I was filled with peace. So yes, I do have the fear of speaking in front of people, contrary to what many people think. But one valuable thing I learned from Verbum Dei is what we share is the fruit of our dialogue with the Lord. So today, as we begin our 2024 Lenten journey, let us imagine ourselves on a Valentine Day with Christ. Christ, our King of missionaries, while here in Christ the King, focusing on our identity as missionary disciples. Who is ready to start this 40-day journey with him? I think we all are. In our Advent recollection last November 29, Michelle introduced us to Mr. Synodality, who attended that recollection. She shared that synodality means walking together with others in communion with Mr. Synodality himself, with Jesus. Where is Jesus asking us to walk to? Let us consult him. There are three main aspects of synodality: communion, mission, and participation. Today, let us deepen on mission. So what is mission? To best understand mission, let us turn to the person who lived his mission so faithfully. Let us turn to Christ. Christ, who is our model of what mission is. Did you realize that Christ was a missionary? And what a busy missionary he was. He had a full schedule. Thanks to the Gospels, we saw how Jesus performed his mission. He went from town to town, proclaiming the good news, teaching and preaching, healing, miracles everywhere. Let us look at the list of these people he healed. There's the blind man Bartimaeus, the man with the unclean spirit, Simon's mother-in-law, the leper, the man with the withered hand, the servant of the Roman centurion, Jairus' daughter. Jesus healed them all. Then there's Sam. You guys remember Sam? The Samaritan woman, whom he healed from her fears. He worked and taught day in and day out. Sometimes he didn't have time to eat. And his relatives called him crazy, crazily in love with us. In Hebrews 3, we are told, therefore, holy brothers and sisters, who share the same heavenly call, turn your minds to Jesus, the apostle and high priest, whom we confess. In my experience, one very effective way to turn our minds to Jesus is praying the rosary. There's a rosary group here I know who prays every day. Because of this talk and reflecting on mission, while praying the luminous mystery, I noticed even more how Jesus lived a life of mission. Then I thought, instead of the luminous mystery, we might as well call it the mission mystery. Jesus himself, the good news of God, was the very first and greatest evangelizer. He was so through and through to perfection and to the point of sacrifice of his earthly life. So let us continue looking at him and learning from him. Every Christmas, my husband and I look for a good Christmas movie to watch. Last Christmas, I was led to watch The Chosen. Who has seen it? I'm sure many of you here have seen it. I was a bit late. Please make time to watch it. You will see how Jesus didn't stop calling, teaching, healing, loving, showing what mission is all about, and how his whole life was a mission. He was not only a missionary in the last 3 years of his life, but his whole life, from birth to death until now. It's a good reminder that like Jesus, our whole life also should be a mission. One of my favorite scenes was Jesus meeting the Samaritan woman, as you saw earlier. In the talk of Michelle about synodality, she pointed out how Jesus showed synodality with Sam by seeking her out. What struck me was how that encounter with the Lord transformed her and moved her to mission, to joyfully proclaim the good news to all. Our mission is not a one-time thing. It is continuous. Our mission is from the time we wake up in the morning until the time we sleep. Pope Francis said, I am mission on this earth. That is the reason why I am here in this world. I am mission on this earth. Like love, mission is a decision. It's not a feeling. There will be times we won't feel like doing any mission, but it's not about a feeling. It's about making a decision to make our whole lives a mission. So as I reflected on this talk, I asked the Lord, Lord, what is the mission you want to entrust to me this 2024? And I stayed with that question for a long time. During pandemic, there was a workshop by Father Dennis about finding your mission. The task was to come up with your personal mission statement. And how funny the acronym, PMS. He said, many may think they don't have a PMS, but they are in fact already doing their mission. They just haven't written it down. So write it down. For those working, you have your own company mission statements. Here are two of the best mission statements. Try to guess the company. To inspire and nurture the human spirit, one person, one cup, and one neighborhood at a time. Starbucks. To bring the best user experience to customers through hardware, software, and service. Apple. I attended an EO business conference in Indonesia with over 50 countries represented, and I was very struck by the first question the speaker asked. Why do you do what you do? We revisited our company's mission statement that workshop and arrived at this mission: to spread joy and love through our jewels, one person at a time, Melody Jewels. And everything changed. It became even clearer why we do what we do. And if we have these mission statements for our companies, why not for ourselves? So after much prayer and consultation with the Lord for my PMS, I was led to these words: to bring souls to heaven and heaven to souls through prayer and our Blessed Mother. Must say this is already an updated version after working on this talk, as it is a process. One image that really moved me was the image of Jesus' baptism when the heavens opened. You are my beloved Son. With you, I am well pleased, and the heavens open. I always believed that this is exactly what happens when we pray. When we pray, heavens open. So if you want the heavens to open, pray. And we know that we can experience heaven now. We don't need to die to experience heaven. We can experience heaven right now. One theologian says, when we go to Mass, we have one foot in heaven and one foot on earth. I was floored when I heard this. And of course, it made me go to Mass even more. And in the Our Father, we pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. One volunteer who attended World Youth Day shared that if you want to experience heaven, attend World Youth Day. So for me, my PNS is another way of saying to bring people to prayer, which is heaven. To bring the good news to others, which is also heaven. And always through our Blessed Mother, who is the shortcut to heaven. So I decided to make this my mission. What's your personal mission statement? When I make certain decisions, I ask myself, will this bring souls to heaven and heaven to souls? Will this make others experience heaven on earth? If the answer is yes, then do it. If not, then drop it. And all of a sudden, everything I do has meaning and purpose. Nothing is wasted. So there's no need to be afraid of the mission. Embrace it. Even my pains and struggles, I try to remember to offer it for souls to go to heaven. As my late mother taught me when she was dying of cancer, she said, "Iha, don't waste your pain." This is why I wake up every morning excited to face my day. Two guiding questions my spiritual director always points out. Why do you do what you do? And for whom do you do what you do? This is why I do what I do. This is why I am here standing in front of you. Living out our mission also bears many fruits in our lives. One fruit is our children's faith journey. My husband and I decided long ago to send our children to traditional schools where they would grow and in an education grounded in faith. That, plus what they saw growing up, it was only natural that they would find themselves in faith-growing activities like Loom 18, Antioch, and attending World Youth Day. Not because we told them to, but on their own initiative. They were watching us. As St. Mother Teresa said, it's in Spanish, but the English version is, don't worry if your children are not listening to you. They are watching you all day. So let me summarize the invitation to three things. And if this is the only thing you remember, then it's okay. One, discover your mission and write it down. Number two, embrace your mission. Don't be afraid of it. And number three, believe that I am mission. Decide to be that mission. Let us go to our point number two. We receive our mission directly from Christ's compassionate heart. This mission is not from us. This is a God-given mission. In John 20, we are told, as Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. How amazing our Lord is. He gives us his peace before sending us out. He knows this is what we need. He is reassuring us that there's no reason to fear the mission. I am sending you with my peace. It's a beautiful prayer that came from Jesus himself. This is the same prayer we repeat every time we attend Mass. Unfortunately, we often say it routinely. But this peace the Lord gives us is what he is asking us to give others. Think about this next time you go to Mass. Then he says, as the Father sent me, so I am sending you. Lord, where are you sending us? To whom are you sending us? The next part is even better. He breathed on them and says, receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus is giving them the Holy Spirit, an advocate who will be with them till the end of time. May I invite you to try this? Close your eyes and imagine Jesus beside you. He's so close to you, you can feel him breathing on you, almost embracing you. Then imagine him saying, Vicky, receive the Holy Spirit. Julie, receive the Holy Spirit. John, receive the Holy Spirit. You need to be close to Jesus to feel his breath. Jesus was saying this to his apostles directly. Can you imagine how they felt? They had no church. So how would they interpret their mission? From prayer. How about us? We must train ourselves in prayer to discern directly what mission Christ has for us. So how is the best way to train ourselves to listen to the voice of the Lord? A continuous dialogue. Every morning, ask the Lord, what do you want me to do for you? And don't forget to listen. Pray. Pray with the word. Because we know when we pray, we talk to God. And when we read scripture, God talks to us. Saint Teresa Benedicta of the Cross says, let go of your plans. The first hour of your morning belongs to God. If you're thinking what sacrifice to do this Lent, want to try this? Instead of reaching out for your cell phones in the morning, get your Bibles and read the word, his love letter to you. And ask him, Lord, what are you trying to tell me through your word? Try it for 40 days. And if it brings you closer to the Lord, then continue it. They say it takes an average of 2 months to form a habit. And for sure, the familiarity will come. And it is in this familiarity with the Holy Trinity that moves us to mission. May I ask, who thought of themselves as a missionary in this room? Raise your hand. I am a missionary. We are all missionaries. To begin with, I never thought of myself as a missionary. My idea of a missionary was someone who was sent out of a far place, lives and dresses simply, and does the mission full time. Michelle Toots and I were discussing after one soul, and we said, we don't fit the mold. But the reality is, we are missionaries. We are all missionaries. We, each one present here, is a missionary called by Christ. And because we are all missionaries with a common mission, then we are all co-missionaries. So all of a sudden, everywhere I looked, I see missionaries. I am reminded of one of my favorite sayings from St. Catherine of Siena. Be the person God created you to be, and you will set the world on fire. One morning, I was telling my husband how I love these Grab and Lalamove drivers who make our lives easier and how they were our heroes during COVID. That afternoon, while driving to the office, I was getting upset at all the riders who were cutting me and who were inserting themselves. And I stopped and I thought to myself, but Yvonne, they are missionaries. They are missionaries with a mission. And you know what? Everything changed. All of a sudden, I wasn't upset anymore and I became more patient. And since then, I always try to make it a point to send them a message of thanks. I'd like you to meet two very special missionaries I love. My mother-in-law, a most prayerful missionary who tirelessly serves her family and all those around her from the time she wakes up until the time she sleeps, if she sleeps at home. And Sister Isabel, my spiritual mother, whose gift is to listen to others, giving them great comfort, like our Blessed Mother. Then Michelle and I went to see my pulmonary doctor because of our month-long cough, and he took care of us. Thank you, missionary Doc Abbott Nalido. Doc Abbott's secretary, Lori, The guard at the entrance of the hospital opening the car doors, even my driver, Louis, and my two girls in the house, May and Grace, they all became missionaries in my eyes. Here lies the importance of prayer and familiarity with Christ. And who else will know the heart of Jesus more than his mother? His mother, who would be most familiar with her son's compassion, and for sure, by looking at her son, she would grow in her own compassion for others and carry it to all. This is what moved me to say yes to the mission of building the Ephesus house for a mother who brings everyone to the compassionate heart of her son, not just for their own sake, but to connect them to the mission and their gifts as well. Have you heard this equation? Need plus talent equals mission. When I see a need and feel I have a talent to do it, that is a calling. That's mission. The problem we have is so many excuses not to believe what the Lord is telling me, not to use my gift or talent, maybe somebody else could do it because nobody told me, or maybe because I don't take my gift so seriously. I believe our Blessed Mother helps connect the needs of the world and our talents to help the missions we have been given. A good friend, Bobin Sandai, who found his mission through prayer, always shares the words of theologian Frederick Buechner, who says, "The place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet." How beautiful is that, right? So what is the world's greatest need? The world needs good news, especially since the world is already filled with so much bad and false news. The world needs God. We need God. We all need God. Can you even imagine a life without God? The mission, therefore, is to bring Jesus to all we need, to make every occasion an opportunity to bring Christ to others. To be, maybe it's to smile through a word of encouragement, our presence, a gift, giving guidelines like this. My last example is so, our school of the word, becoming Zo, Zoom of the word. When pandemic struck and lockdown happened, we were all concerned how to continue so, as we could no longer gather face-to-face every Wednesdays in Christ the King. The need was to continue bringing the word to others, especially during that uncertain time. Moving so online was a solution, but in this case, I had no talent. What I had was a burning desire to bring the word of God to others. And that was enough for the mission to be born. I remember suggesting to Father James to try to do so on Zoom, even if I had no idea how to do it, nor a proper laptop. But thanks to a friend who showed me the possibilities, I had the courage to try. Thanks, missionary Patty Pineda. I was so nervous on our first Zoom session. I was supposed to play music for reflection after Father James' guidelines, but what played was Zumba music. And I didn't know how to stop it. It was so embarrassing, but I learned. And we haven't stopped until today. Thanks to missionary Johnny, Monette, Father Georgia, Father Michael, Father Iwao, and Peter, and many others for being the co-pilots to this mission. So when I was asked if we will continue the hybrid, my answer was yes. For as long as it can help even one soul, we will continue it. Again, this didn't come without struggles, anxiety, and pressure. And personally, it was very hard for me to enter into deep prayer because of all the technical stuff. I had to remember that there are times we need to leave God for God. So in this second point, three things to remember. One, our mission comes directly from Christ's compassionate heart, so we need to stay close to him. Number two, we need to train ourselves in prayer to discern our mission. And number three, to see the other as a missionary. The third and last point, Jesus wants to send us as a community of disciples. According to the Synod of Synodality, the unity of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit involves us in a mission that moves us from I to we and places us at the service of the world. Wow, how powerful is that? The Holy Trinity moves us from I to we. The Synod brings out two main points, formation and attention to the poor. Let us think as a community. I see so many communities represented here by amazing missionaries who are already faithfully involved in the mission. There's Christ the King, of course. There's Couples for Christ. Tony Menotta is here, another missionary. There's Paraiso. There's Antioch. I know they're online. Of course, the Assumption community is also here. Today, let us reflect how we can reach out even more to our society in concrete ways as one community. In the recent National Conference on New Evangelization, the cardinal in charge of organizing the synod with Pope Francis shared how he believes that in the Philippines, there are three areas to work on in terms of synodality. The first is with the youth, formation of the youth. The second is sensitivity to the poor. And a third, a commitment to joy. A joy that Filipinos naturally have because of their resilience. And also the culture of joy, which is the same culture of the gospel. Let us deepen on these three areas and discern how we can be more sensitive so we can grow this Lent in the awareness of what my mission and what our mission is. Let us ask the help of the Holy Trinity. After all, it is our relationship with the Trinity that sends us from I to we. For the first area, the youth and formation of the youth, I can't help but remember World Youth Day, that many say is one of Pope John Paul's greatest gifts to the Catholic Church. Who has been to World Youth Day here? So, do you agree with me that it's where people experience heaven on earth? My daughter, Karin, was blessed to have been able to attend the World Youth Day in Panama in 2019 with the San Antonio Parish Delegation. And I am most grateful for the formation given to her. Because of Verbo Dei, who teaches us how to pray with the word, I was inspired to arrange sessions like so for the group, since this formation would surely help their preparation. Learning to pray with the word of God is education itself that involves formation of the mind, heart, and will. It is so important to train ourselves to learn, to educate with the word, which is the most impactful influence that we can have in our society in terms of a more holistic education or formation. My dad used to tell us, and my sisters are here, Jackie and Michelle are here, always be part of a class so you will continue to grow. You remember that? I never thought it would be a class every Wednesday in a school of the word, but what a gift it has been. And I'm sure he will approve. And it turned out to be the best preparation because I realized that World Youth Day is noisy, right? It's noisy. It's actually hard to pray when you're there. So one must learn how to pray before going. Otherwise, you will get lost. Same in this world, right? It's a noisy world we live in. And it's so important to learn how to pray, which right now is not an option. It is a necessity. This preparation is as important as World Youth Day proper itself. And I know this for a fact because I ended up there even at 50 years old. I ended up accompanying my daughter who almost didn't make it. She got sick 2 weeks before the trip and was confined because of blood loss. We were told by the doctors there was no way she could leave. A week after her delegation left, we had another blood test that would determine if she could follow. And by some miracle, She just made the cut. And the doctor said, you can go to Panama if your mom goes with you. I had no plans of going, but it seemed like God had other plans. In 2 days, we were on a plane and we made it on time for the opening ceremonies of Pope Francis. I was clearly sent on a mission to help and be of help and that needed parent leader to assist the group. And yes, we had more time for formation, not only for Karin's delegation, but with the Virgen Dei Colombia delegation who I met there. Wasn't that wild? This encounter with the Lord made me an advocate of World Youth Day. Not just me, but also Matt and Sandy, who were delegates in the previous World Youth delegation. And yes, and they said yes to the mission to be the adult leaders of World Youth Day Portugal last year. This was last year. My son joined this, and I was very thankful to the two adult leaders who said yes, because they took care of my son, among other people in the room. I wasn't surprised that their encounter with the Lord led them to mission. It's not very easy to lead a group like this. And this is exactly the encounter of Sam, the Samaritan woman. Her encounter with the Lord led her to action, to mission. That's part of the formation, the mission. It doesn't end with the encounter. All these personal encounters with the Lord must lead us to mission. So please block your calendars for the next World Youth Day in 2027 in Korea. And that's not only for the children. I was 50 when I went to World Youth Day. The second area to work on in terms of synodality is sensitivity to the poor. Saint Marie Eugenie, our mother foundress in Assumption, would say, prayer must flow into action. This was part of our formation in Assumption, together with the immersion programs that many graduates declare was life-changing. Toots Magsino is a living testimony of this formation. Toots is an artist at heart and a teacher who spreads the joy through her love for art. Aside from being a volunteer art teacher to cancer patients at Carewell Foundation, she also makes it a point to reach out to those in need, including those in the streets. And I mean street vendors and homeless people who she actually befriends, building a closeness on first name basis and a continuous communication. The list of her good friends include Ronald the Tahog Vendor, Elsie the Barquillos Lady, the Bibinka guy, the Sampaguita guy, and even a homeless couple in New York. Toots pointed out that she saw Jesus in them. Our mission has to touch the poor. How can we think about touching the lives of the poor and having missions for them? One thing that Virgen Dei can offer is to form them as disciples, to teach them how to pray. This way, we are teaching them to take care of themselves and not rely on others for their destiny. I know some sowers here who are already doing that. They go to companies and conduct sows there, and they also offer it for the kasambahays twice a month. For a while, it was in the house of Tita Corito, another amazing missionary. The third area we are invited to work on is the commitment to joy. As a final invitation, let us reflect on what the Lord wants to tell us in Matthew chapter 9. And when he saw the crowds, he felt sorry for them because they were harassed and dejected, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. So ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers to his harvest. He summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits with power to drive them out and to cure all kinds of disease and all kinds of illness. We saw how Jesus was very busy with the mission, but when he saw the crowds, he felt sorry for them. And because of his compassionate heart, he told the disciples to ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers to his harvest. The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. He needs missionaries who will allow themselves to be sent into the harvest and with other co-missionaries. This room is filled with missionaries. Will you give your yes to the mission? This mission that will give us joy, because we are living out the purpose of why we are here on earth. This joy comes from a confidence in God's love, in his compassion, and ideally also in the church and the work we are all doing. At this point, I invite everyone to pray with the Good Shepherd, our King of Missionaries, who says, "The harvest is rich, but the laborers are few. Lord, send us out, your workers." Pope Francis says, Lent is a time of grace, a season of conversion. Let's not waste it. We are all called to a missionary conversion this Lent. I never saw myself as a missionary. Well, I never saw myself as a mission, nor as a missionary, and others as co-missionaries. But this was the clear invitation for me and each one of us here to focus on the mission Christ, our King of Missionaries, has given us. Remember that no one else can do our mission. If we don't do it, nobody will. So as we begin day one of Lent today, let us remember these two invitations: to see the other as a missionary and remind them they're missionaries. And number two, to allow ourselves to be sent into the harvest with co-missionaries. And if we do this, no doubt, come Easter Sunday, when Christ will resurrect from the dead, we will be able to experience a deeper kind of joy that only comes from him. And when we come face to face with him, we can say we have tried our best, and that is enough for God. God willing, we will hear his words, the words we would all want to hear when we are called to join him in heaven. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Come and share your master's joy. So are you ready for the mission? Are we ready for the mission? Happy Lent 2024, my fellow co-missionaries. Lord, help us to become the missionaries and co-missionaries that you have created us to be, so we can set the world on fire with love for you. So for our reflection questions, number one, imagine Jesus, our King of Missionaries, in front of you and ask him, Lord, what mission do you want to entrust to me this Lent 2024? Write it down. Number two, recall the lay missionaries in your life that the Lord sent to bring you closer to him. How did they help you? Pray for them and thank the Lord for them. And number three, the Lord said, the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. What do you feel the Lord needs your help with? What gifts has he given you to help the mission? Where is he sending you, and who are your co-missionaries going to be?